Thank you very much. And wasn't that amazing to see such incredible bits of work from Boys Division Graphics and from Girls Division Art? So well done to all the peoples involved, and many thanks to the staff for putting that together. So as Philip said, we're going to talk you through a little bit about what this year has been like. That's what we would do if we were here in person. And we thought you might be interested to know what it's been like at school during these difficult months. As you can imagine, when lockdown occurred, it was a little bit of a shock to realise that we were going to be in the school buildings without children. But one of the great things that we could draw upon was the fact that all the girls and boys in years three and above have their own iPad. And so, to their immense credit, the staff of both the Girls Division and the Boys Division immediately went into action and ensured that lessons continued for all our pupils in real time using the iPad. So we became aficionados of Zoom very quickly. I'm sure you're all very used to it now as well. When we started, I'd like to point out that the only person in the foundation that used Zoom was me. I think that was something that made everyone laugh, as I'm not necessarily known for my IT skills, but it was something we'd been using in the Girls School Association to contact one another. But soon we had all the pupils, all the staff using Zoom. We had protocols in place that they needed to have their background hidden, so hence my chocolate in the background. And we also made rules about what they had to wear, hence in the Girls Division we are still wearing jackets and we're not into jumper mode, unlike the Boys Division. Certainly it was tricky for the staff to have to deliver lessons over Zoom, but the students responded with immense aplomb, and loads of parents, many of you may be attending tonight, had very kind words to say about the relationships which they could hear live over Zoom, and for the quality of teaching that we managed to continue. One really important thing was to decide what to do with year 11 and year 13, because as you'll be aware, when the decision was made to shut schools for the summer, the decision was also taken to not have examinations in the summer term. And so it was pointless to carry on teaching GCSE and A-level much beyond the end of the course. And we needed to do something to provide an education for those students, given that they weren't going to be taking exams. So in both divisions, we quickly put together a programme of post-GCSE and post-A-level learning. And on both sides, we were really impressed by the way that the students responded to that, but also very impressed by the way that the staff put together things using, for example, MOOCs and information that was out there on the web at very little notice at all. As I'm sure you can imagine, there were no Easter holidays for people this year. We were just getting ready for the summer. But it did mean that it remained a very, very productive time. And I think that that's something that really the independent sector has immensely benefited from, the way that we've been perceived to respond so proactively to remote learning. And of course, in our context, with a high level of children who are here with support, the fact that we have given everyone an iPad meant that there were no distinctions between those children who could or couldn't access remote learning, which has maybe been an issue in other places. So we were also minded to give parents a discount, because many pointed out that the children were not having their lunch in the normal way, and there were many other features which were not happening, which maybe people would expect. And in giving that money back, we did say that if parents were able to forfeit the discount and to allow us to keep it, that would in fact go to help other parents who were maybe experiencing hardship at that time. And I'm very grateful to those of you among the donors tonight who showed such generosity of spirit in saying that you waived that discount for the good of the school, and in particular for parents who were maybe finding lockdown much harder than you were, who maybe had been furloughed or even lost their job. We know that there are difficult economic times ahead, but we hope that with the support of donors like yourselves, we will be able to come through stronger at the end of all this, and making sure that we preserve the integrity of our community. So that just leaves me to then introduce the next bit of tonight. And we're going to hear, we're going to see some technology. We have Billy, who has created a stop motion video and is a winner of the Creative Arts Award in Boys Division. And then we have some examples of Girls Division product design and textiles. And you're even going to be able to watch some videos with students and teachers. So I'm just going to cue Laura now, who's going to get the video running, and Philip and I are going to disappear from your screens.
Hi, I'm Elsie. I opted to study product design at AS because I enjoyed studying design and technology at GCSE. I chose the exam board's contextual challenge of outdoor learning for my non-exam assessment coursework piece. I chose this particular challenge as I'm keen to design prototypes that encourage users to acquire new skills or improve existing ones. I chose to develop a prototype that encourages children to learn new skills independently and gain confidence. My prototype is a play slide with numbers and language skill features. My aim was to create a prototype which would promote independent play, develop physical capability, and encourage counting and foreign language learning.
Hi, I'm Katie. I opted to study design and technology at GCSE because I enjoyed designing and making prototypes throughout Key Stage 3. I chose the exam board's contextual challenge of working towards a sustainable future for my non-exam assessment coursework piece. I chose this particular challenge as I am keen to design prototypes that are environmentally considerate. I chose to develop an environmentally considerate prototype for children. My prototype is a multifunctional box which houses traditional board games. My aim was to create a prototype which would promote interaction between children and within families, providing an alternative to screen time.
Hi, I'm Amy. I decided to study design and technology at GCSE because I felt that it could offer important skills that other subjects cannot, such as being creative and time management skills, which would be very valuable in later life. I chose to create an armchair-shaped cushion to help travelling businessmen and women to feel comfortable and create a relaxing environment in their hotel rooms while working away from home. The cushion cover is made from a dark polyester fleece and is filled with acrylic stuffing. I've included multiple accessories such as a cup holder, pockets and a handle to allow the product to attend to the customer's needs. I drew the fish on the pockets by hand and then used the CAD embroidery machine to create the detailed image. I consulted my target market throughout this project, receiving criticism and opinions to make sure that my product meets all of my target market's needs and wants. I am now enjoying studying this subject at A-level.
This baby teepee was made by one of our recent leavers, Honey Hyam, as part of her Year 13 final piece in textiles. Following detailed research, Honey was keen to develop a product that would adapt and change as a child grew older. She has incorporated a stimulating play mat made of a range of fabrics with different textures, and it is reversible, so it doubles up as a changing mat to make life easier for the parent. Inside the teepee, there are a range of hanging toys for a baby to reach up to. And as the child develops, the teepee doubles up as a play den. It is an excellent example of a student responding to a target market's needs, testing their ideas through modelling, and creating a product that works really well in practice.
Thank you very much. I'll take up the story now where Sue left off and bring you to the start of autumn term, I think. What might you see if you were in school right now? How does the school during COVID times feel? One of the things, of course, is you know that I've spent quite a bit of time over the years trying to create firsts at Bolton School. And every time I do declare that we're doing something for a first time, usually some old boy or old girl at one of our events reminds me that it happened usually about 70 years ago and is distinctly old hat. But of course, the last few months have been a wonderful time for me because I've been able to assert, for example, this evening, that this really is the first online donors drinks without drinks. And I'm sure we've never done that before because after all, why would you have a drink without any drinks? I did a virtual prize giving in June as an assembly. One of the more surreal moments was appointing the new monitorial team by Zoom rather than calling them to the study. And so a lot of our work has moved online. Right up to date with yesterday evening, we held a panel discussion for the Tillotson lecture online, and that was another first. If we were in the Leverhulme suite right now, what you would be doing is seeing tables arranged at carefully placed green ticks 2 meters apart, because as an example of school life, that is one of the venues we've chosen to set up so that we can meet there socially distant. And so the COVID protocol there would be one of staying apart from one another as you would out and about in your everyday lives. Once you go into either division, the protocols, as you probably know, are different, where what keeps us safe is the year group bubbles, keeping groups of children together with fixed friends in their form groups or year groups, so that we would know who should self-isolate in the event of someone becoming ill. So, for example, in boys' division, you would not find the maths and English department anymore. You would find the year 7 and the year 9 rooms in which they study for the vast majority of their curriculum. The scientists are taking experiments to the rooms, which was even more exciting before we managed to switch the fire alarms off in those rooms as well, which should not really have been an afterthought, but then that's the chemistry department for you. They're used to their own little fiefdom. But taking the activity so far as possible to the classrooms reduces movement, keeps things safe. We have different lunch arrangements. You will find magnificent marquees pitched outside the back of the girls' division all the way along the playground there where the netball courts are. And in boys' division, you would find a marquee pitched in that part near the Dobson Road quad, where, in fact, in years gone by, we built the catch, and those marquees are used as social spaces and also for lunch arrangements where we need to keep those different groups of children separate. There are protocols in the Riley Centre to make sure that year 12 and year 13 are kept separate, although boys and girls are bubbled together because they must share some joint teaching. It's a very different feel to everyday life. At break and between lessons, it will be more the teachers moving around school than the girls and boys, although there is still some movement on both sides. And that very different rhythm, of course, has required a degree of adaptability. And it's been great to see that the young people in school, the boys and girls, have been enormously adaptable and did so very quickly. Colleagues have followed on, and I guess that is a sign of age, isn't it, for us all? As we get a little older, we become perhaps a little less flexible in our ways. For example, across this side, one of our lessons now starts at a slightly different time And I think the world record was a colleague who 5.5 weeks into term eventually admitted that he hadn't quite realised that yet. I guess the boys were doing something, probably reading an erudite book whilst their teacher was absent. And it might be argued we should have noticed. But hey, those are the difficulties of these more challenging times. What I would say, and I think what you'd like to understand, is that in all of our doings, we have been really careful to be safe and secure, to keep as many girls and boys in school for as long as possible, therefore making sure that there isn't contamination within school. We are fairly clear that all the positive cases we've had have come from outside school and family circumstances, which is understandable rather than anything that we are doing here in school. And we've been very focused on doing as much as we possibly can. There hasn't been much talk around here of what we can't do or moaning about what can't be achieved, but a lot of focus on how can we make something happen? How can we add as much joy and richness to school life as possible? And I think that is what you would want to hear. One way in which we've done that, of course, as I said, is using online methods to keep in touch. And alumni have been terrific in that regard. That giving of time online to be part of broadcast careers. Sue referenced the pre-university courses, and both girls and boys in our alumni body contributed remarkably to that endeavour in the summer, giving of their time to give lessons sometimes based on their university experience and certainly to share thoughts about university life. And in so many other ways, it's been great actually to draw in a much wider range of alumni where travel perhaps had previously been an issue, but appearing on screen and giving of time has been that bit more possible. One of the examples of moving routine school events online has been that both girls' division and boys' division have had virtual concerts and pupils have recorded music and that has been played, often at a particular time so that there is a sense of collective endeavour, a moment when it happened, but then on YouTube for viewing later. And those have again achieved arguably much wider audiences than a concert in the Great Hall. And there will be lessons learned for the future that perhaps we will enjoy physical events, but we'll also seek to share them more widely with the wider community of school through online streaming. And what we'd like to do now is share with you some of that music that has been recorded, some specially for this evening, but also some that was part of concerts earlier in the year. And we'd like to share those musical items with you now.
My name is Freddie Orley, and I'll be playing an excerpt from Wonderwall Atarka by Mozart. Thank you.
Thank you.
So thank you very much. That last item was from our Year 7 concert. So every year we ask the Year 7 to come together and to sing a great concert for their parents. We do that sort of 6 weeks into their time at Bolton School to prove just what they can achieve in such a small time. Now this year, of course, we couldn't do it as a whole year group because potentially we would compromise our form group bubbles. So instead we asked each form to put together a song, and isn't it amazing what the girls can manage in such a short period of time? I'm sure it gladdened the parents' hearts to see that things were progressing as normal. And I suppose one of the key notes tonight is to just stress to you how we have tried to keep the show on the road as much as possible, so that nothing in the education that we offer the boys and girls is compromised by COVID. And one area where things have remained very much the same is in our attempts to raise money to support those children who attend this school with financial aid. As you know, we have currently one in four of our students attending on a bursary, and our aim is to get to one in three by 2030. And I'm delighted to say that so far this year, we've raised £672,000 for the bursary fund. So that's an immense tribute to the work of the Development Office, and to all of you who have so generously donated to the school, and shown that you have faith that we will keep going no matter what, and that we will carry on with our endeavour to make this school as socially inclusive as we possibly can. So on behalf of both Philip and me, a huge thank you for your generosity, and we could not do it without you. So that money has helped us to give bursarial support to 52 new Year 7 pupils this September. They have joined our school communities. Nobody knows who they are. They are fully integrated into everything we do, and they're able to benefit from an education which their parents would not otherwise be able to afford. And we think that's part of us living out the legacy of Lord Leverhulme, that a Bolton School education should be available to anyone who would benefit from it, no matter what their financial background and who their parents are. So a huge thank you for everything that you've done to contribute to their education, and we hope their successful lives going forward. So we've heard many examples of our children's abilities and talents in the musical field. But what about in drama? Well, we're about to now see what the girls and boys can achieve in a dramatic context. We're going to start with Grace with something from A Midsummer Night's Dream. And then we have some examples of girls in the Festival of Speaking that we held in the summer. Speaking was one thing we could still do online, even if other drama had to end. And then the boys' division are putting on a show, It's a Wonderful Life. A very good optimistic title to have when otherwise things could be a little bit down at the moment. They're going to do that very imaginatively using lots of virtual means. And we're going to see here some auditions for that great show. So sit back and enjoy, I hope, some examples of the girls and boys' dramatic talents.
Well, George Bailiofsky, hey, a fine pal you are. What are you trying to do, steal my girl?
What do you mean? Nobody's trying to steal your girl. Here's Mary.
No, wait a minute. I want to talk to both of you. Tell Mary to get on the extension.
He wants you to get on the extension. Mother's on the extension. Now we can both hear. We are listening, Sam.
I have a big deal coming up that's going to make us all rich. George, you remember that night in Martini's bar when you told me you read someplace about making plastics out of soybeans?
Soybeans, yeah, sure.
Well, Dad snapped up the idea. He's gonna build a factory outside of Rochester. And here's the point, Mary, you're in on this too. Now listen, George, have you got any money?
Money? Yeah, well, a little.
Well, now listen up. I want you to put every cent you've got into our stocks. You hear? And George, I may have a job for you. That is, unless you're still married to that broken down building and loan. This is the biggest thing since radio, and I'm letting you in on the ground floor. Oh, Mary?
I'm here.
Would you tell that guy I'm giving him the chance of a lifetime? You hear? The chance of a lifetime.
Good morning, George. So good to see you again.
Mr. Potter, this is quite an unusual request.
What's that?
You're calling to ask me to pay you a visit.
I don't know what's so unusual about it. I just think the two of us should get better acquainted. Here, have a cigar.
Thank you, sir. This is quite a cigar.
I like it. I'll send you a box.
Well, I suppose I'll find out sooner or later, but just what exactly did you want to see me about?
That's what I like about you. George, I'm an old man. Most people hate me, but I don't like them, so that makes it about even. You know, as I do, that I run practically everything in this town, except for the Bailey Building and Loan. You know also that for some time I have been trying to get control of it, or kill it. But I haven't been able to do so. You have been stopping me. In fact, you have beaten me, George, and as anyone in the county will tell you, that takes some doing.
The four mechanicals are in the woods, practicing for a play. But they face many problems. For example, Bottom wants to play every part in the play, but the other mechanicals disagree, leaving them arguing. When back rehearsing, Puck, a fairy working for Oberon, accidentally turns Bottom's head into a donkey's head. Bottom doesn't realise and wonders why the other mechanicals are laughing at him. The mechanicals decide to run away, leaving Bottom alone and upset. He decides to sing a song to show he isn't scared. La 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 la, but wakes up to Tanya. Da da da.
Caged Bird by Maya Angelou. A free bird leaps on the back of the wind and floats downstream till the current ends and dips his wing in the orange sun rays and dares to claim the sky. But a bird that stalks down his narrow cage can seldom see through his bars of rage. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. The caged bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still, and his tune is heard on the distant hill, for the caged bird sings of freedom. The free bird thinks of another breeze, and the trade winds soft through the sighing trees, and the fat worms waiting on a dawn-bright lawn, and he names the sky his own. But a caged bird stands on the grave of dreams. His shadow shouts on a nightmare scream. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. The caged bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still, and his tune is heard on the distant hill, for the caged bird sings of freedom.
I come from the strong northern accent. I come from the accent of my school, the you're so posh phrase. I come from the screaming, shouting fans heard from outside the stadium. I come from sport. I come from the urge to win. I come from sportsmanship and being tough. I come from the music in my bones. I come from the loud bang of the drums. I come from the fear of the unknown, hitting me like the pedal of the drum. I come from me.
Hi, my name is Sophia. Today I'm going to be reading out the poem which I read to the current poet laureate, Simon Armitage. 3020 by Sophia. I am a bird, the last one alive. I have flown around the globe and I would like to survive. But on my long travels over continents galore, I have seen atrocities more and more. Australia. No animals to be seen, no green, no trees, no bushes in sight, just the smoky breeze. South America. Vast logs lay long, the Amazon on fire, things that once existed, just part of a pyre. Antarctica. The land which was once a blanket of snow, now lay in the darkness, dead penguins below. North America. In Niagara Falls, stood alone, no fish, no life, an empty zone. Asia. Every sit lays naked and bare, no snow to be seen, total despair. Europe. Not a spot lay raw, plastic floods, strangled animal on the floor, where there once were woods. Africa. Droughts cover the land, starvation everywhere. When you had a chance, why didn't you care?
Thank you very much for those dramatic pieces. In case you're wondering, the Boys Division colleagues did consider casting the parent prompters as well, because there were some frankly hilarious and indeed quite promising performances recorded for us from willing parents at home who helped the boys audition for that show. If I might just add my own comments on our bursary fundraising, which is after all the purpose of us gathering this evening. The foremost purpose of that gathering is to say thank you. We said so at the beginning, we've said so throughout the evening, but I will say so again, because all of you in your different ways have contributed to the success of the school, and one of the driving parts of that success of the school is our inclusivity. It is so important, and I know that you feel that when you visit school and feel it in operation. It's been so important to us throughout this summer in COVID times, that we draw widely from our community and represent all parts of Bolton and North West life. And without that, the school would be impoverished. It would not be the place that you remember or that we enjoy working in. And the core to that is bursary fundraising and us being able to support those who can't afford the school under their own means. As we know, the rationale is the same now as it was more than 500 years ago. Some people in that school out on the moors, when about 200 people lived around Bolton, paid their way at the small school, and some were supported in that endeavour. And I think that is a really important message. This is not new. It is a way of operating education that has existed for centuries. Whenever we get caught up in the current impressions of what independent schools are as part of our society, we do tend to contrast the existence of schools where fees are paid with those that are supported by the state. But of course, we also know that is a transient position. It is how it is now. It is by no means the average position over the centuries that young people have been educated in this country. The average position is a mixed economy, even as recently as schools like this being supported by direct grant and assisted places. It is the modern age that is anomalous, and in that sense, we should not be caught up in trying always to justify our existence. We do, of course, we have to engage in those national debates. But what is really, I think, good about Bolton School is our confidence in what we do, and knowing what we do is of use to the young people here and indeed to the community we serve in Bolton, our part in local civic life and our contributions to national life, reflected so well when we won the Independent School of the Year award a few years ago. I wonder if when we mentioned that a dozen times last year, you thought you'd heard the last of it, but that's not so. We intend to continue mentioning it for a little while in the future. And all of that is our normal context, but there is a particular context this year in terms of our commitment to making sure that the school is as widely accessible as possible, and with your help achieving that. Because in the summer of COVID, this particular year, one thing that is very clear, if there is a turning point in history at all, is an even stronger focus on how society works, how the various parts of society connect together, whether they will diverge and become fragmented, or whether what after all requires a collective effort of dealing with the transmission of a virus pulls society together and inspires our collective sense of togetherness. And one aspect of that, of course, is that it has never been more important to be focused on fundraising and supporting bursaries at this school and indeed around the country, because those social inequalities that may well be magnified by our current times can be addressed if schools such as this represent somewhere where boys and girls of talent from whatever backgrounds can gather, understand one another, learn together, grow up together, and leave here to make a difference for good in the society in which they find themselves. That rationale for our school life is most certainly, I know, why Sue and I work here. It is a huge driver for us that that is the sort of school of which we are proud to lead and happy to give our time and expertise. And it's wonderful in an evening such as this to feel so well supported by you, who are either through your gifts of time or gifts of money, support that very important endeavour to make Bolton School the important part of the future of our local life in Bolton, as it most certainly was in the past. And we can do that. One thing that is very striking for me is that as we emerge from this current moment in national life, and far from pressing pause on fundraising, we increase our zeal in fundraising, is that these very buildings in which we find ourselves and which are so iconic of our modern school life were themselves begun in times straight after the First World War, when austerity was a feature of life, and indeed opened more or less in the height of the late 20s crash. This school played its part in driving forward our society then, and we can in the future. And with that, I'd like to introduce our final musical item, which is by the Joint Concert Band. Again, it was used in our concerts during the summer, and they will play for us Call Me Maybe. Thank you.
That was wonderful. Thank you very much to the concert band. And isn't it wonderful to see all those faces popping up on our screens? Now, Philip has departed because the boys' division are going to be putting on a concert tonight, and he needs to be there for